Most of you know us already. I'm Prophet John, and this is my wife, Pastor Susan. And yeah, once a year, what we do, we have a prophetic school running for about a few months, and this will be for a few weeks because we're gonna do it online. So, but usually, what we do once a month, we have a prophetic school at a venue that we used to have, and due to this year with COVID and due to my health problems, we decided to do it online this year. So, yeah, welcome, and I hope you're going to enjoy the evening with us and enjoy the training. I'm going to hand over to my wife, and she'll start off with the teaching tonight.
Thank you.
About hearing God's voice. It's basically just going to be introduction because we can't sit here as long as we normally are. But yeah, let's see how it goes and we'll take it from there. It's our first trial. So please forgive us if we mess up or miss things or do things wrong. Gonna try our best to be as professional as possible. But yeah, what I'm gonna do. Okay. I'm gonna step us just through some general rules quickly for anybody wanna say something. Okay. I'm just going to step through some general rules quickly for tonight, just so that we are all on the same page, that we all know what's happening. Then I'm going to start with why it's difficult to hear God's voice. Then I'm going to cover a little bit on God as a language for us, because He wants to communicate with us. So He communicates in a specific language, and we need to understand that language. And the prophetic comes with the Holy Spirit. There is no other way to get the prophetic spirit. Anything else outside of the Holy Spirit is not the prophetic spirit. It's called divination and all kinds of things. Interpreting God's language. So I'm just going to guide us through that, how to interpret it, how to look at it, things like that. And then we can cover some questions afterwards. And we'll have some practical sessions and some prophetic ministry as well. So, general rules. What I'm going to do now is I'm going to mute everybody. Because, as you probably notice, if somebody speaks, then there's always a feedback on somebody else, and then you can't hear me and all that kind of stuff. So I just want to set up the rules now on that. I'm just busy muting everybody quickly. Mute, so just so that there's no feedback or any of that kind of thing happening. Now you're going to wonder, okay, when am I going to have a chance to say anything? There's a chat box that you can use. You will see at the bottom of your screen it says chat, or if you're on your cell phone, just go on the that little dots on the right hand side where it says more, just click on that and you'll see there's a spot that says chat. You can write in there anything you want. If you've got questions or anything during the session or whatever, and you may be scared you're going to forget your questions, you can write your questions there and we can cover it later. And then there's an option also of raising your hand if you want to use that option. I'll try and look for it and see when the screen pops up and shows me somebody's raising his hand and want to say something now while I'm busy talking, then I can give you a chance quickly to speak or whatever, so that we don't fall over each other and not everybody speaks at the same time. So just familiarize yourself maybe with all the options and the things that you get and all the things that's available on Zoom. Okay, there's the raise your hand. And then during the practicals, we will give everybody a chance to speak. Everyone is going to have a chance to share something, and it's going to be fun. So I want to encourage you to stay with us till the end if possible. But if you can't, please don't feel bad if you need to drop off or anything. You can just write in the chat goodbye or whatever. You don't have to say much. I'll understand. I'm not expecting anything if you need to leave or anything in between, or earlier or whatever. And I'll share everything on YouTube afterwards as well. So once we're done, I'm going to copy the link from Facebook and I'll make it available on YouTube as well, and then I'll share the link on YouTube as well, and then you can let your friends and family and everybody know if they want to watch the video and see what we've done and whatever. And if you want to go back again to see the word that you received, if you forgot something, then it's like immediately available, so you can go on YouTube and you can go and remind yourself again. And I'm not going to delete the YouTube videos or anything like that, so it will always be there. Okay, that's just on the phone. There's the chat option, and there's raise your hand as well, that option there. Okay, so why is it difficult to hear God's voice? Okay, so I first want to ask you a question. Who of you feel that you never hear from God, or you're not sure if you hear from God? You're very insecure, you're always guessing, isn't God speaking to me? Isn't God speaking to me? What's going on? And you might hope for the best, and it's like a touch and go situation. If you feel that way, you can just write in the chat, yes, that's me. Just to make it a bit more interactive so that we can all talk to each other as well, and you can feel you're part of the session. You can tell me. Excellent, thanks, Charles. I understand exactly what you're saying. I've been there, been through it. You never know what's going on. So it was a touch and go situation for both of us as well, and Letty as well. Yes, we're not alone. We all feel that way at some stage. In the beginning, even as we are now, we sometimes wonder, Lord, is it you speaking, or is it my own thoughts, or what's going on? Please confirm. So don't ever think that you hear everything, that you know everything, and that you're always 100% certain, this is now God speaking to me. But one thing I can say is when God does speak, you know it. Anyway, there's various things that can prevent us to hear from God and to hear His voice on a regular basis. And one of the things the Bible is talking about is a hardened heart. Now, Pharaoh, for instance, he had a hardened heart. The magicians, who knew nothing about God, the minute the miracle happened that that Moses' snake ate all their snakes, all their staffs, they said, this is the finger of God. But then Pharaoh's heart was hardened, and he didn't want to listen to anything. He just said, no, I'm not going to listen to this. So we can have a hardened heart and just say, I'm not going to listen to this. I don't want to hear what God is saying. Or you can say, I don't believe it is God. Even if everybody else tells you, this is God, this is the move of God, this is the Holy Spirit. People can say, no, I don't believe it. I don't want to listen. And those hearts is normally the ones that's insensitive to God and His voice. They're having a lack of understanding, and they become dull of hearing. And it can even be a calloused heart. Now, a lack of understanding is 99% of the case. If we don't understand the situation, we don't understand God's language, we don't understand God's heart, we don't understand His word. And that's normally the case where we become insensitive and we not sure if it is God speaking to us or not. But dull of hearing is normally when we are very religious. You are so used to hearing certain things, doing things a certain way, and then eventually you become dull of hearing. You're like, okay, I can hear it. I hear what you're saying, but I'm not listening. I'm not taking it in. And especially when it's not within your framework, within your understanding, within your way of doing things, and God tried to get the message through to you from the sideline, then you normally push it aside and say, I don't want to hear that. It's like with the Pharisees and the Sadducees and everybody was in Jesus' time. They still struggle today to accept Jesus because they are dull of hearing because of all their religious activities, staying in the law, doing everything according to the law. And when Jesus came and He brought His teaching, they said, no, we don't accept that. And then a calloused heart is somebody that's in the world. So I'm going to explain that a bit more. I'll get to that now. But Jesus said to the disciples, there was a case where he increased the bread and the fish and everything and did the miracle. And then they were in the boat. And Jesus was talking about something completely different, about the leaven, that they mustn't have the same leaven as the Pharisees, and they didn't have bread. And they were wondering now, is Jesus pointing to them because they don't have bread with them or anything like that? And Jesus picked that up and he said, no. Do you not yet perceive or understand? Are your hearts not hardened? Having eyes, do you not see? And having ears, do you not hear? Do you not remember? In other words, we can have ears, but we don't hear. We can have eyes and we don't see. And we can have understanding and yet we don't grasp what God is saying. And that was the problem with most of Israel. And that's why the disciples asked Jesus in Matthew 13, why are you speaking in parables? And he said to them specifically, the reason why I'm speaking in parables is because they have eyes that do not see and ears that do not hear. So he's trying to get the message across. Now the heart of the world becomes calloused. They never hear anything about God. All they hear and see every day is the sinful life, lust of the eyes, lust of the flesh, and the pride of life. That's the only things they hear. So they get a calloused heart. They have a lack of knowledge and understanding of God and his ways, because nobody tells them anything. They don't see anything. They don't believe anything. Like your atheists, for instance, they've got a calloused heart. They don't want to understand. They don't want to see. Even though it's happening right in front of them, they will still question it, still wonder about it, just not believe. And God says in Isaiah that his people, for a lack of knowledge, are being destroyed. They're going under, they're falling by the wayside because they've rejected knowledge. And he says, if you reject the knowledge, I will also reject you, and you shall be no priest to me, seeing thou hast forgotten the law of thy God, and I will also forget thy children. So there's a ripple effect that even our children struggle to hear from God when the parents forsaken God and his laws and his ways and forsaken what God is calling them to do. So if we struggle, it might be our parents or our grandparents or further back in history that our families didn't want to know anything about God, and now we struggle to hear from God. So that can also happen. So we as Christians must watch as we come acquainted or familiar with the things and the ways of God, especially we as preachers, that eventually we'll get to a point where it becomes general knowledge and we can become full of pride and think that you know it all, thinking that I know how to run a ministry and nobody can tell me anything. And then they become less and less dependent on God, and they don't want to hear from God anymore because they know how to handle every situation. The thing is, in when we know the situation or we don't know the situation, then it's easy to run to God and say, Lord, I don't know how to deal with this. But when you know how to deal with everything, then we've got a tendency not to listen to what God is saying, and we sometimes miss his voice. Always be sensitive. Be like David. Every time he had a problem, he ran to God. Doesn't matter what God said the previous time, he would ask God, must I go and do the same as the previous time, or must I do something else? And then the Lord says, no, now do you do something else. You're not going to do the same process again. So we need to be sensitive to hear God's voice at all times. Never think that you know it all. Never think that you know how to run a ministry. Always check with God, what is his will, what is his way, where does he want to go, does he want to go with next? And he might surprise you. And it's very dangerous. And it's actually more dangerous when you start thinking that you know it all. So, if a worldly person now somehow hear the word being preached, faith normally rises in their hearts and they can still hear God speak to them. And then they turn. They change their lives. But we as children of God are full of pride within God's kingdom. We could easily miss it when God speaks to us. Other things that can also cause us not to hear God speaking to us is doubt, unbelief, bitterness, fear, or being emotionally unstable. And that one is a very dangerous area as well. Then you can hear all kinds of things and then you think it's God's telling you that. We've heard of people that is suicidal and all kinds of things, and he's very emotional, and then he prayed, said that God must show him something, and then he got a message and he thought he, I think it was a scripture or something that he got, and says he must go and kill his, was it? Can you remember?
I don't remember who it was, but it was the person what he said. He asked the Lord if I'm a, you know, I'm commit suicide, and the Lord gave him the scripture of it was what was it?
I can't remember the scripture now,
but but it doesn't matter. But the thing that happened, that the person heard the voice of the Lord that he must kill his whole family. So because of emotional disturbance that was in his heart, he heard the wrong message from God, and God actually wanted to tell him, no, you mustn't commit suicide, and he was so emotional about it that he did the wrong thing. So you must be very careful if you're in emotional or you're sad or something like that. You won't hear the proper voice of the Lord. So just be careful of that one, okay?
And we always need to stay humble, stay in faith, and be very sensitive to his voice at all times. Something about that emotional instability. We sometimes just need to say, okay, let me go and sleep it off, calm down, relax, and let me ask God now to speak to me. Like with Elijah, in Elijah 19, when he was so upset and frustrated and depressed and everything after this awesome experience he had on Mount Carmel with the fire of God falling, and the killing of the Baal prophets, and everybody saying, yes, the Lord, he is God, the Lord, he is God, and everything. The next morning he heard from Jezebel that she wants to kill him. And he just got so emotional and down and depressed. He just like, no, this is not worth living. I don't want to carry on like this. And he, depression just hit him. And he went and he laid under a bush. And he didn't want to eat or anything. And then God's angel came and he woke him up and he said, you must eat. The road you have to walk is far. And he ate and he just turned around and slept again. Later on, the angel came again and he woke him up again and he gave him some food to eat. And he ate and he got strength to walk for 40 days. And he found a mountain and he went and he hid himself into a cave. And then he heard a rumbling. He first heard the the earthquake and a fire that was there. But he says the Lord is not in the earthquake and the Lord was not in the fire. But after the fire, he heard a still, small voice. And it was so when Elijah heard it that he wrapped his face in his mantle and went out and stood in the entering of the cave. And behold, there came a voice unto him and said, what are you doing here, Elijah? Elijah was so sensitive towards God's voice. He knew the earthquake, this mountain is shaking. He didn't run out. He didn't think this is now God speaking. He heard the fire and everything. He just moved deeper into the cave, but he didn't come out or anything. But when he heard the voice of God, he came out worshiping, wrapped his face in the mantle and stood in the entering of the cave. And we need to be so sensitive that when God actually speaks, that we hear him, that we humble ourselves, and we recognize his voice. And God loves that still, small voice effect. It's very powerful. Even the Holy Spirit, it's a humble voice, but it's a very strong authority that speaks to you when he speaks. And that's why I say, when God does speak, you know this is God speaking when you hear his voice. But there's a language that God uses, because He is the Word, and Word speaks. John 1 verse 1 says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, was with God, and the Word was God. Word speaks. There's two words in Greek for word. If the one is logos and the other one is rhema. The logos is the complete word, which is the Bible. But then the rhema word is like a verse in the Bible or chapter or whatever. So, so when God is speaking to you, He can give you the whole Bible and say, go and read. Or He can give you one scripture, one verse to speak to you. And you need to be sensitive enough to hear His voice at that moment when He speaks to you. And God hasn't been quiet ever since Genesis 1. He's always been speaking, and He wants to speak to us. He wants us to hear His voice. But He has a language of His own, and we call that the prophetic language. And for us to understand Him and to know that it's actually God speaking to us, we need to understand God's language that He is using. So everybody's signals going or something like that. As God wants to communicate to His children, He does that mostly through dreams and visions, His Word, Spirit, revelation, even through nature, using natural things to try and explain spiritual things to us. And He's using it via parables. He even speaks through signs, wonders, and miracles, or a still, small voice. So we need to be open and ready to hear from Him at any moment in time. And even when we do our shopping, or fetching the kids from school, or just doing our daily tasks, working, cleaning, anything, God can speak to you at any moment. So be ready. Always have your ears open. And you need to understand the prophetic language in order to understand the way God is speaking to us. But if we are dull of hearing and our hearts are calloused, we miss the promptings of the Spirit. It's that still, small voice. And sometimes the way God would come and speak to us is He will gently remind you. He will be like a shepherd calling you. And it will be like a leading and a guiding. It's not always and a voice that you hear and say, go this way, go that way, do this, do that, whatever. Sometimes it's just the sensing in the Spirit. So it's like a prompting of the Spirit. God doesn't grab us by the neck and says, you must go this way, you must go that way. He guides us, He leads us, and we need to be sensitive to always pick that up. And like with the prophet Isaiah, with King Hezekiah, God gave prophet Isaiah a message. He went and He delivered it to Hezekiah and said, the sickness that you have, you're going to be, is going to be unto death. You're not going to make it. And he prayed for him and he left. And while he was still in the palace, but walking out, God said to Isaiah, now turn around and go back to Hezekiah. Because after Isaiah left, Hezekiah prayed. And God heard the prayer and He said to Isaiah, no, turn around, go back to Hezekiah and says, no, I'm going to add 15 years to your life. Now, Isaiah could have doubted. He could have questioned and said, Lord, is this you? Is that what you want? You just said he's going to die. Are you sure he's now going to live? What's happening here? But Isaiah understood God. He understood the voice. He knew God was talking to him. And he made a U-turn right there, and he went back to Hezekiah and he went and prophesied to him again, and he said to him, I'm going to live for another 15 years. But even then Hezekiah was doubting, and Isaiah was saying, you ask what you want God to show you, to prove and to confirm that this is God saying this to you. And then Hezekiah was saying, well, Isaiah gave him the option and said, must the the grease on the sundial move 3 degrees or 5 degrees forward, or must it move 5 degrees backwards? And Isaiah, Hezekiah asked that it move backwards, meaning the earth must reverse, the time, it must go back in time. And it actually happened. So they both got the question and the answer and the confirmation and everything at that moment because of faith and asking and trusting God that this is God speaking. So never be afraid to ask for signs as well, but ask it in the right attitude and the right, can I say, with the right heart. But sometimes we can be very arrogant as well and we say, Lord, I want a sign and I want a sign now. And then sometimes you don't get a sign. Like in Jesus' time when the Pharisees and everybody came and said to him, you are the Son of God. And he's like, I've showed you so many signs already. Which one don't you see? So in other words, they had a calloused heart, they refused to believe. They didn't want to hear. And Jesus says, the only sign that will be given to you is the sign of Jonah. So sometimes we get that as well. So be careful when you ask for a sign and be in the right mind. Because we need those revelation moments and we need to hear when God is speaking. But God can speak in other ways as well. He speaks in the inner conviction, that sixth sense that you sometimes get. That telling, can I, that sixth sense of telling you what to say or not to say. And sometimes when you prophesy, you feel like, okay, stop here now. Don't carry on. Don't say anything more. Be quiet. If we're not sensitive to that, we sometimes say too much or we overstep our line or whatever like that. And if we, especially people that love talking, they can talk themselves right into trouble and talk the other person right out of the prophecy if they're not careful. So we need to be sensitive when we're prophesying and have that inner conviction when the Holy Spirit talks to you. Peace. That's a big sign that we need to listen to at all times. Have you got peace in your heart about a decision, about a direction, about the choice that you're making, about the word that you need to bring? If that peace of God is not in your heart, but you feel uncertain, you feel insecure, or you've got fear and you've got doubt and you've got a lot of questions, then wait with whatever decision you want to make, wait with whatever you want to speak about till you get that peace in your heart. The same with if you want to step into ministry, for instance, and things like that. If you don't have the peace of God about doing something, don't do it. That peace is showing you God is with you. He's happy with what you're doing. He's satisfied with it. You've got his thumbs up and he says, go for it. And he will be with you. But if you don't have that peace, then step back and wait till you get that. And if you stand before multiple choices, multiple options, multiple directions, check which one you have peace in. That's the direction you must go in. The others will give a stirring, even though the other one might look right, but you feel uncertain or unwelcome or whatever. Then you know, don't go that way. Because if you do, you're just going to get trouble. Other ways sometimes as well that I've found that God speaks to us is through writing. It could be music, especially people that's good in music, that flows in music. God can come in prophetically in their music and they can just play a song that they never played before, or write that song, or whatever, poetry, literature, or just the letter. For me, the letter side is what's working perfectly. Sometimes I write a letter to God and then I wait till I feel He wants to speak to me, and then I just write whatever comes to mind. And then I read it afterwards, and normally when I read afterwards, I can just say, this is God speaking to me, I must listen, I've got peace about it, I'm happy about it, and I've got my answer. And sometimes I even get a revelation at that moment, and I'm like, wow, I never thought of it that way. Then you know that is God speaking to you. But you get people that just start speaking. They don't hear anything, they don't see anything, they don't feel anything, but when they open their mouth, they start speaking. If you're one of those people, take a recorder, take your phone on the record and record yourself.
Just to stop there, people, Susan is speaking about, sometimes about that you will hear, it's like a head that comes up, it's like a bubbling up of words, like a spirit, and then you will start writing it down. But I know I sometimes I flow in that gifting as well, but it will become like a poem. All the words will rhyme with one another. So that's what we call the Nathan prophet. Nathan was one of those prophets where the words just started bubbling up like a brook. Okay.
Okay, so always be ready to hear from God and expect that He wants to speak to you and He wants to speak through you in revealing things which are mysterious and otherwise unobtainable. What I've found sometimes is that God speaks to me in the situation I'm in my frustration, in the midst of my problems, in the midst of my criteria and whatever. He didn't give me any revelation up front, but He gives me the revelation in the midst of my trouble. Many of my things that I write and whatever comes from my past experiences, the things that I've went through, and God was speaking to me in that moment. And that was like, wow, now I understand, why am I going through this? Now I understand what I need to do, how to deal with the situation, what to pray, things like that. So you need the prophetic and you need the Holy Spirit at all times, in the midst of your situation, in the midst of your storm. Otherwise, you might miss it. And if you're not sensitive and you just sit and complain and whatever and cry and, Lord, where are you? And Lord, I don't hear you and all that kind of nonsense. and ask me, I go through that often. You have to go and be quiet and say, okay, Lord, I'm listening. What do you want me to hear? And when you start listening, then you get your revelations, you get your answer, and you get your way forward. And as I said, the prophetic comes with the Holy Spirit. There is no other way. Now, God stopped speaking with an audible voice to people during the time of Jesus. That was the last time that people were saying, we heard God speaking, and they said it was like a trumpet or a thunder. For instance, in John 12, when Jesus cried out and said, let your name be made holy, and God said, I've made my name holy and I will do it again. But people was like, some said it was like a thunder or whatever that they heard. They didn't know what they were hearing. In Exodus, they were saying that God's voice was like a trumpet. So it was scary. It frightened people. Everybody was like, what was that when they hear it? Even in Revelation, when they talk about when the Apostle John talks about the voice of Jesus, he says, it's like a mighty rushing waters that he turned around when Jesus was speaking to him. And then later on he says he was like a trumpet. So God don't really want to speak audibly outside of us anymore. In Matthew 17, on the Mount of Transfiguration, God came in the bright cloud, overshadowed them, and behold, a voice out of the cloud which said, this is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. Hear ye him. In other words, we must listen to him now. God wants to speak through Jesus now. He doesn't speak himself so much anymore. He can if he wants to, there's nothing stopping him. But it basically is now through Jesus. And therefore in Hebrews 1 verse 2, the writer wrote, because we don't know if it's Apostle Paul, if it's somebody else, there's lots of arguments about it. But whoever wrote Hebrews said, he has in these last days spoken unto us by his Son, whom he have appointed heir of all things, by whom also he made the worlds. He's spoken unto us by his Son. He wants us to listen to Jesus now. But now, as we all know, Jesus is not in the flesh anymore. He's nowhere to be found on earth, so I can't say, okay, he's in Russia, I must buy a ticket, I must go to Russia. Or he's in Israel, I must go to Israel to go and hear him and listen what he's saying. Because Jesus has ascended, as we all know, and he's in the spirit. So how do I hear Jesus today? I hear him through the presence of the Holy Spirit. Jesus explained between John 14 to 16, he says, the spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it sees him not, neither knows him. In other words, the world can't see him. Their hearts are hardened, their hearts are calloused, they don't have any understanding, so they can't see him. And neither do they know him. But you know him. How do we know him? We know him through his presence, we know him through his love, we know him because we are born again children of God. We are Holy Spirit filled. That's how we know the Holy Spirit. That's how we know that he is with us today. For he dwells with you and he shall be in you. And then Jesus said this extra part of the sentence, I will not leave you comfortless, I will come to you. So how is Jesus coming to me if he sends somebody like him? So in other words, the Holy Spirit is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit all in one. It's one God, but he's three personalities in one spirit. In John 14:20, Jesus says, that day you shall know that I am in the Father, and you are in me, and I in you. But the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send in my name, he shall teach you all things, and bring all things to your remembrance, whatsoever he said unto you. And then 2 Corinthians 3 verse 17, which is the verse that opened this up for me. The Lord is that Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. There he says it clearly, the Lord is that Spirit. We don't have to argue it. So Jesus and the Holy Spirit is the same Spirit. He comes to us through the Holy Spirit. So if you want to hear Jesus, get acquainted with the Holy Spirit. Now, I normally use the example of water. Can everybody see my glass? It's a bit difficult to explain it here, but I'm going to try and do my best. I've asked God once, why is he using water so many times in the Bible? And prophetically, there's so many scriptures says he will come like the rain, like the mighty rushing waters and things like that. Even your creation was about. So I was like asking God, why? What is it about water? And he said to me, water is the physical representation of the Spirit. Not necessarily Holy Spirit, just Spirit. Any form, any kind of Spirit. You can look at the qualities of water and you will understand Spirit. Now this is where parables are coming in. The purpose of a parable is a physical thing, a physical example to explain a spiritual truth to you. So water is a physical example to explain to us how the spiritual side and the spiritual world is working. So if I take water, for instance, and I have three bottles of water here and I pour them all in my glass, you won't know which water comes from which bottle. All of them are coming together as one, mixed up. Even if it's different, three different colors, when I pour them together, it becomes one color, one ugly color, and you won't know where that water came from which bottle, because you can't say, okay, this drop of water belongs to that bottle, this drop of water belongs to that bottle. So everything is joined together, and it's the same with God as three persons in one spirit. It's Father the Son, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit is one spirit that comes to us, but you can experience God as a Father, as Jesus, or as the Holy Spirit. You can experience him in all three persons when they come to you. You will feel and sense, I'm talking to God the Father, I'm talking to Jesus, or I'm talking to the Holy Spirit. It depends on the character that he brings to you at that moment. The revelation he gives to you will show you whether you have a relationship with the Father right now, or if you have a relationship with Jesus, or if you have a relationship with the Holy Spirit. John 14:23, Jesus says, God makes his dwelling place with us. Meaning that through the Holy Spirit, we have all three, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, joining himself with us. You can go and look at 1 Corinthians 6 verse 17 as well, where Paul writes and says, he who is joined to the Lord is one spirit with him. Now it's like the, it's a prophetic idea again that's coming across from marriage. Because when the son, or can I, yeah, it says the son will leave his father's house and he will cling to his wife and they will become one flesh. In the spirit it's the same. Jesus left the house of the Father, he came to his bride, clings to his bride, and now we become one spirit. So Jesus is here on the earth, he's just in the spirit, and he joined himself with us through the Holy Spirit's presence in our lives. And that's how everything comes together in that. And that's how, when the Holy Spirit speaks to you, flows through you, and you get baptized in the Holy Spirit, then the nine gifts start operating in your life. 1 Corinthians 12. Or the nine fruits of the Holy Spirit will also start operating. You must just allow it to operate. That's from Galatians 5. Or the fivefold ministry gifts that you get, the apostle, prophet, pastor, evangelist, and teacher. That's from Ephesians 4 again. So you get all those gifts coming from, or working through the Holy Spirit. There's no other way that you can have that happening. And that's when your prophetic gift starts operating in a person's life. And they can now start hearing the voice of God in their hearts and not just audibly outside of us anymore. So at first we don't understand what is happening, as we don't understand this new language, and we need to be trained in it. And that's where Dion and I fit in. God called us to help the body to flow in the gifts of the Holy Spirit, to understand, to make things easy, to help us to open the Word, to open the Scriptures, to open the Spirit, and help people to understand what it means to flow in the Holy Spirit, to operate in the prophetic, operating in the gifts. And that's what we're going to do. That's what we're going to train you in as we go along. And it's going to be a little bit at a time. We're not going to do everything in one go. There's too much to share. So tonight, all I'm going to touch on is interpreting God's language. But we're going to, for next week, we're going to go further into it. As I said, you need to be sensitive. But God speaks through impressions. His language is through impressions. In other words, he's not normally speaking actual words. You sense his love, his approval, or his grace. You sense the loving touch. You sense the Spirit around you. So we need to be aware of what's going on around us. And the quickest way to learn how to be aware of your surroundings is if you're in a room, step out of the room for a minute, then come back in and notice the difference in the atmosphere. Some people will say to you, if there's like negative situation in a room or whatever, this atmosphere is so thick you can cut it with a knife. Then you know this is, there's contention, there's struggle, there's problems, there's fighting, all that kind of things. But when the Holy Spirit's presence is in a room, it's a holy atmosphere. It's a different type of presence. And I found the quickest way for me to recognize if God is in a place, especially in a church or in a venue or wherever we are at that moment, is God there? I step out of the room for a few minutes and then I come back in. You will sense that there's a huge difference between outside the door and on the inside of the door. There's a different presence hanging there. There's a different spirit, a weightiness. That's what they call the glory of the Lord is like weighty, it's heavy. You feel that presence hanging in that room. Then you can know God is there. You don't have to question it. You don't have to ask about it. And as you get to know that, and that loving presence of Jesus, that's one presence I very seldom experience. I can feel the power and the glory and all of that, but that loving, gentle presence of the Holy Spirit and of Jesus being in a room or in a place or in a church or during a meeting or something like that, that seldom happens. And it's normally when people are very, responsive to the Spirit, responsive to His love, looking for Him, asking for Him. That's when His loving presence starts manifesting in a place. And when you get that, be very sensitive to it, respect it, love it, appreciate it, adore it, worship it. Because He wants to come to you and He wants to touch you at that moment. And it can disappear like that. And then it's hard to get it back. It's not easy for it to come back again. John 1:20, it talks about the unction from the Holy One. He says, you have the unction of the Holy One, and you know all things. That unction of the Holy Spirit is that you sense it, you feel it, you feel that He's pushing you in a direction, but so gentle, you can resist it. You can at any moment say, no, I'm not going to go with this. No, I'm not going to do this. But know that when you resist it, He will step back and He will leave you alone and He won't push you to do something, He won't force you, and you're going to miss a blessing. It's better to listen to it, to obey that moment, to walk with that, to just flow with it, just listen, just do, just say what He tells you to say. You're going to see the miracles, you're going to see the wonders of things happen. And you're going to stand amazed afterwards and you're going to just say, wow, Lord, was that you? That's how God works. It's an unction. It's a gentle prompting of the Spirit. It's an impression that you get. I need to listen to this or I need to do that or whatever. Sometimes you feel like, I must just do this. I don't know why. I must just do this. Later on, you'll discover why. 2 Peter 1:21, Peter writes, he says, for the prophecy came not in old time by the will of man, but holy men of God spoke as they were moved by the Holy Ghost. They just felt this presence of God, they call it the hand of God, that came upon them, rested upon them heavily, and as they just flowed with that Spirit, listened and obeyed, the word starts flowing. And that's how that's how the whole Bible was written. Not just most, the whole Bible was written. It's because of that move of the Holy Ghost. They spoke by faith. They trusted what they believe, what they sense, what they feel. This is God speaking. I'm just going to flow with it. I'm not going to keep quiet. I'm not going to hold back. I'm just going to flow. And many of the prophets had scribes with them. So when the prophet started speaking, the scribe would start writing. So just imagine, they didn't have a computer. They had little scrolls that they had to write on. And somehow that scribe got that message across. I don't know how. It's amazing. That must be God's Spirit upon that scribe at that moment as well to also write that message together with the prophet. So the word prophecy, by definition, in Greek, is the word pro and femi. I'm not sure how to pronounce that. The word pro means beforehand or before time. That femi or phani or whatever how you pronounce it is saying. In other words, saying something before it happens. That's what prophecy is. You speak it before it happens. That's how prophecy works. So prophecy is foretelling, forthtelling, teaching, writings, or verbal utterances under the inspiration of the Spirit of God. But note, it's not fortune or predictions. Using all kinds of funny things like tea leaves and crystal balls and horoscopes and all that kind of stuff that comes with it and tarot cards and all that. That is divination. That is trying to do the prophecy, but in a dark way without the Holy Spirit. So if you go for all these reading of hand palms and all these horoscope type things and all these crystal balls and tea leaves and anything that you try to use to try and get the message out, know that you are not busy with the Holy Spirit. You are busy with divination. So be very careful of those kind of things. Be very careful of people that does those kind of things. What I always say is, when they start with fortune telling and predictions and all that kind of stuff, it is it's a fear-based prediction type thing. You don't know what's going to happen. Normally something that scares you, it's something that gives you, makes you feel insecure, it makes you feel like your hair standing up and all that kind of stuff. Then I'm not even talking about mediums and all those people. There are more people flowing in the negative than what there are people flowing in the true prophetic spirit of the Holy Spirit. So be very careful, and there's a lot of things going on, I've noticed it especially on Facebook, of predictions, which is not foretelling, forthtelling, or prophecy, it's predictions. They're using the scriptures and they predict what we're going to go through. They predict what we're going to be, and they use it to try and just say everything's going to be well, you're going to be blessed, whatever. And the way they say it is all prediction. It's not prophecy. Be very careful of that kind of stuff. Sometimes we grab those things and everybody's like, amen and yes and hallelujah and whatever. And I'm like, you're going to fall into a trap. This is the darkness trying to lead you into a trap if you fall into those things. Listen what the Spirit of God is telling you specifically in your situation. You can't tell a million people out there all at the same time God's going to bless you. Make sure who you speak to, make sure who you talk to, be careful of that. And there's another thing what we call a corporate prophecy, which can be for the church in general. Remember, the prophetic is for the believer. It's not for the unbeliever. The tongues is for a sign for the unbeliever to tell you that God is in the place. God is speaking to them. But the prophecy is not for an unbeliever, it's not for a sinner, it's not for somebody that's not born again or anything like that. Sometimes people will prophesy over people that's not born again or anything like that, but 99% of the time, prophetic is for believers. It's for Christians, it's for children of God, it's for believers. And it's for Holy Spirit believers. Because the purpose of the prophetic is to edify you, to encourage you, to uplift you, to motivate you, to give you hope, to give you direction, to give you purpose, to help you in your situation that you are in. That's the purpose of the prophetic. You can go and read 1 Corinthians 14. It explains the differences between tongues and prophetic very nicely. I'll get into it as we go along later on. Following courses or following sessions. So what makes it prophecy, according to definition, is the sphere of formation, which is eternity. Because when God speaks, he speaks prophetically outside of our time, in the arena of eternity, to be manifested in our time. So prophecy relies a lot on dreams and visions, to hear God's voice, to get those images across and to get that symbolism. It depends on symbolism and parables and those kind of things. So even parables is all prophetic. Everything we see and feel and experience in the physical can be used or seen as a prophetic explanation of what exists in the spirit. It works like a parable. Isaiah 12 verse 10 says that the prophets act out parables. In other words, when you get some crazy prophets, they will take a physical thing and they will do something strange and people will like, no man, that guy is crazy. We don't know what he's doing. He's acting out something to manifest that spiritual truth that he wants to happen. So that's how that works. That's how it all comes together. So don't think a prophet is crazy if he starts doing funny things. It's like John the Baptist. He was wearing a skin, was it camel hair or whatever, and he was eating locusts and honey, and he's like in the desert, and that's why Jesus asked people, why did you go out to see when you go and see John the Baptist? Why did you go out there? Because this is a weird guy, what's he doing out there? He tried to stir people to understand what a prophet is, who a prophet is, what does he do? And a prophet will attract people. He will attract people to, out of curiosity, to come and see what he's doing. Because he needs to get people's attention, so he needs to be weird. So if you sometimes feel like you're going to have to be weird to do something, or if the Holy Spirit tells you do this or do that, and you're like, Lord, I don't want to be weird, then remember this. He wants you to act out a parable to bring a message across that only God can actually confirm in the end. If you go and read Ezekiel's story, what he's been through, and all the things that he's done. So Jesus spoke to the multitudes in parables to bring across that secret truth regarding the kingdom of God. So if you want to know anything about the kingdom of God, go and read all those parables about the kingdom of God. Because he says, for instance, the kingdom of God is like a mustard seed. Now, so in other words, you're going to have to go and look at the quality of the mustard seed, the type of the seed, compare it to other things, and then see what it does. And then you'll understand what the kingdom of God does. As he says, it's the smallest of seeds, but it grows the biggest of not just seeds, the smallest of your fruit seeds, fruit and things like that that you can eat. But he becomes a tree. All your fruit is normally tomatoes, your vegetables, fruits, all of that is small trees. It's not big, but the mustard seed, when he grows out of that small seed, is a large tree. So that's what the kingdom of God is. He starts small, but it grows. When it takes root, it will grow, and it will grow in strength, and it will draw people, and it will bring change and all of that, and people can find shelter and comfort and all of that in the kingdom of God when you allow that seed to grow in your life. So some of the functions and objectives for prophecy is to help people to find their destiny, to reveal ministry for people, to bring correction, bring blessing, change, creation, healing, power, instruction, counsel, impartation, empowerment, and so I can carry on. We will go into all nine gifts over time, and I'll explain all of that, how the different gifts help you and work with you and how you flow in it. And the ability to see and hear in the spirit needs to be developed and practiced without the interference of the physical senses. So prophecy flows from intimacy with God. So you need to have your quiet time with God, daily basis. I would suggest even morning and evenings if possible. Even if it's just 5 minutes, just sit and just wait on him for 5 minutes and just say, Lord, just fill me. Lord, just speak to me. You don't always have to read the Bible. You don't always have to worship. You don't have to play music. You can just sit quietly and just wait on him. Sometimes he will speak to you. Sometimes you will just feel him. And sometimes you will just feel nothing. But then, because you waited on him, God will meet you somewhere. Maybe during the day, maybe the following day. I had a case, for instance, where I waited on God, I fasted, I prayed the whole Monday through, nothing. It was as dead as anything. The Tuesday morning, I fell on my knees out of my bed. I started praying. I haven't even halfway finished my sentence, and the Spirit was there, answering my prayer, giving me a revelation, speaking to me, and I was like so stunned. It just took everything out of me. But the previous day, there was nothing. I can remember my friend, she wanted to buy me coffee. I said, no, I'm fasting. I just want water. She said, can't I get you anything else? I said, just water. And she brought me a bottle of water. But she was looking at me very curiously. What's going on with you? What you on about? The following day, I could explain to her what was going on. But that day, I was like, Lord, you must speak to me. I need you now. I'm waiting on you. But it was the whole day. I was committed that day. I want to hear from God. And the next day, I mean, he spoke to me. So don't ever get discouraged or whatever. If you want to hear from God now, and he's as quiet as anything, he doesn't respond, he doesn't say anything, you don't feel him, you don't sense him, nobody phones you, no WhatsApp, no message, no nothing. Just relax, just wait. He will come. And then you can experience the following types of combinations of them that spend time in God's presence. You can experience feelings or sensing his presence, like that sixth sense I was talking about. You can have visions or pictures in your mind, or even open-eyed. Some people will get open-eyed visions. They will look at like an IMAX theater situation, and the visions plays off in right in front of them. But most of us, we have to close our eyes, and it happens in our imagination level. And that's when we get so lost and confused, and we wonder, Lord, is that you, or is it only my own imagination now? Don't write off every imagination or everything that you see and experience. It's just your imagination, and just ignore it. Especially children. Listen to what they say. Because they're so open and sensitive to the Spirit, you would think that that's they're talking nonsense, or it's just their imagination, they're just making things up. Be careful. Listen what they're talking about. Write it down and wait a bit. Pray about it. Ask God, what is this? What is going on here? Is this from you? Is there something else maybe that's affecting my child? Or what is going on? Because a child doesn't know. A child is just open in the spirit, open in the heart. Their faith is pure. They just believe whatever you tell them. They're like a little sponge. They just take it in. So if they hear negative things, they could react negative. They could speak negative. They could come up with all kinds of dark things. But if they are in the presence of the Holy Spirit, the chances are they're going to speak prophetically. I've heard of small children that brought big preachers high up in the rankings, down on their knees, because of a prophetic word that God had to speak through a small child, because nobody else was willing to bring that message to that preacher. And that preacher wasn't willing to listen. So he uses a small child to bring that message across. So it can happen. So listen to what children are saying. I've heard of one child, for instance. He came out of hospital, he went for his tonsils to be taken out, but the tonsils were still bleeding afterwards. And he came running to his mom and he says, Mommy, Mommy, Jesus came through the window and he's putting his hand where the blood is. And she was like, what's this kid talking about? What is his problem? About 2 days later, they had to rush him to hospital. Nobody knew that he was busy bleeding. If they listened to him, the first moment he was saying that, especially if he's saying Jesus is putting his hand where the blood is, that's already giving you indication there's something going on. This kid is not making anything up. Find out what's going on. Go to the doctor, do checkups or whatever. But that kid eventually passed away because nobody listened to him. Nobody wanted to hear what he's saying, and he bled himself out. So when they actually checked him afterwards, they realized there was blood running continuously and nobody picked it up. So listen what kids are saying. And then you get a hearing as well in the spirit, sounds or a voice speaking. Now, I'm not talking about people saying, I'm hearing voices. That's schizophrenia. But when you hear God's voice speaking, it's a different type of way. It's a It gives you direction. It gives you purpose. It gives you hope. It gives you a maturity. That voice of God is a level of maturity you're not going to hear from anything or anyone else. But the best part is it normally feels like yourself. It normally feels like your own voice speaking to yourself, and that's what making it so difficult to understand. And the reason God is doing that is because He's speaking through your spirit. So you need to listen. How does that voice sound, and what's the words coming from it? There's maturity in it. There's loving, tender, care, compassion, upliftment. It's firm and authority. You know that you know. This is now God speaking. This is nothing else. So you need to distinguish between the voices that you hear. Normally your own voice, what you think, what you say, most of the 99% of the time it's your own voice. But then God's voice comes in between and He speaks to you. But then you get the voice of the enemy, Satan, and you get demonic voices as well. So you listen to what they're saying. And if people are telling you, I hear this voice saying all kinds of things, and you know this is not biblical, it's not conformed to the word, nothing, then it's a demon confronting that person, making that person's life miserable, and you need to take authority and control over that situation and deal with it. Other senses that we sometimes experience, but that's very rare, is taste and smell. It's normally people that's very strong in the prophetic that will experience those things. I've had it once or twice already, but in most cases, I'm at a point of sensing His presence, hearing His voice, and seeing visions. I don't even dream dreams much. Very seldom that I dream a prophetic dream. The revelation you will receive is often totally illogical for the normal mind, so it can cause fear and uncertainty. But that fear is a different fear. It's more a, ooh, if I do this now, Lord, what am I going to say? If they question me, if this is not working out for me, Lord, what am I going to do about it? Lord, are you sure it's you? That kind of fear. The fear that demons and the demonic world and Satan and all those attacking you comes with, it's like a fear gripping your heart that you like become numb. You get insecure, you feel like intimidated, overwhelmed, all that kind of stuff. Then you must know this is not God. But when you get that total illogical revelation from God, that voice that tells you, put all your money in the offering basket, for instance, and you will hear many people say that, and they will say, "Weg Satan, leave me alone, go away." That's insecurity. Lord, how am I going to cope for this month? How am I going to make it for this month? But He tells you, put all your money in the offering basket. But if you do that, the blessings that come afterwards, when you listen to that voice, it opens doors, it brings things, it changes situations, and it's awesome experiences with God that you will miss if you don't listen to that. But it normally becomes such an anxious feeling inside of you. It feels like your seat is burning you. You have to do this thing. You just can't sit still. Because God knows that if you don't do that, He can't bless you. And He knows you have to act out a parable in order to get that breakthrough. And that's part of the prophetic. That's part of the message. Don't go and do these kind of things because you hear somebody else experienced it. Now you think, okay, now I must go and put all my money in the offering basket tonight. And then nothing happens. And you're like, Lord, why didn't you bless me? The question is, did you actually hear God telling you to do that? If He didn't tell you something, don't go and do something because somebody else tells you to do that. Find out from God what He wants you to do. Don't let people intimidate you. You'll find a lot of these television, TV programs or whatever, many of them are awesome revelation programs, awesome messages, but when it comes to offering, they try to manipulate all your money out of you, and you think you're doing the right thing and you just do this, and then you wonder, Lord, why am I not getting blessed? Why am I not getting my breakthrough? I've sold myself right into bankruptcy, into debt, and nothing's happening. And then God says, but I didn't tell you to do this. you listen to somebody else manipulating you, don't ever be manipulated. Now, I'm not saying don't give. God wants us to give. I've got a whole teaching around tithes and offerings and first fruits and how it all works. But again, it's principles that we follow, principles that we do, but you never must manipulate anybody and never ever be manipulated by anybody when you give. You listen to God. When He tells you to do something, then you do it. So always measure every experience and revelation with the Word and with Scripture. And that's my last sentence. If it is the same context of Scripture, then you can stand on it. And that's where I'm going to end my teaching for tonight. I think I've said enough. I hope it was a bit of enough revelation for now. Okay, so let's go over to questions. I'm going to put that up, and I'm going to stop sharing. I'm going to give you all a chance to speak. View and gallery view so I can see you all. So, anybody got questions? Does any of it make sense? Did you pick up anything? You are allowed to speak or whatever. You can unmute yourself.
Yeah, we appreciate it. Very helpful teaching in these last days, and I see that the season is a prophetic season. There is a season for apostles, pastors, evangelists, but this season is the prophetic hour, the prophetic era when the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ draws nigh. So, with the teachings, very vital and timely. It's an eye-opener, and the verses also help us. We hope we are going to learn more. It's also a request that maybe after the presentations, you are going to send the presentation, the seminar, to our email so that we digest and do a recap, but it's very, very helpful, and it's pertinent of what is happening in this hour. We appreciate. God bless you.
Thank you, Edward.
Thank you.
Anybody else got a question?
Susan?
Yeah, Lydia.
So if you basic pray, do you always have to pray in the name of Jesus Christ to the Lord, or can you just use the name like God or Heavenly Father, or do you always have to go through Jesus Christ?
Well, Jesus says, I am the way to the Father. Nobody comes to the Father but by me. So what he's trying to say is, if you want salvation and if you want to experience the love of the Father, you first have to come to Jesus. You have to recognize him, you have to acknowledge him, you have to receive his offering on the cross, all of that. But once you've gone through Jesus, you can speak to the Father directly at any time. You don't have to now first say, like the Roman Catholics, for instance, say we pray to Mary because we can't speak to Jesus directly. That's not the case. Mary has got nothing to do with it. That's a false teaching and all that. They bringing all kinds of things in there, but I'm not going to go into that now. But you can, once you've gone through Jesus, once you've received the Holy Spirit, once you've experienced the presence of the Father, you can speak to the Father at any time. You don't have to go through a ritual or anything like that. You just pray to the Father. And it's the same with the Holy Spirit and the same with Jesus. You can speak to Jesus directly, you can speak to the Holy Spirit. But it's a good thing, especially when you do deliverance, healing, that kind of thing, when you say in the name of Jesus Christ, I say this or I speak that, especially when it comes to authority, then put the name of Jesus there, because your that authority, the name, is the name above every name. That's where every knee shall bow, every tongue shall confess that Jesus is Lord. So you need to bring that authority across. That's when you say in the name of Jesus. So depending on the type of prayer that you pray, but if you in your closet time, when you pray in secret, when you just talk to the Father, remember it's Father, Son, and Holy Spirit with you at that moment, at all times, seeing you in secret. So you can just speak to the Father. You can just say amen at the end. You don't have to say, I pray in the name of Jesus. Because you're a Christian, you're Holy Spirit full, you already abide by Jesus' calling, and you came through the cross, you baptized in Jesus, you baptized in the Holy Spirit. In other words, you already have the name of Jesus written all over you. So you can just speak to the Father. But when you speak to for healing and things like that, declare the name of Jesus at the end and say, I'm speaking in the name of Jesus.
Jesus,
this in the name of Jesus.
Yeah.
Then you put your foot down.
Yeah. And can I just ask another question?
Yeah.
You said earlier on that sometimes I also write whatever I get into my heart, I write instead of speaking it. Mm-hmm. And I've belonged to a certain page. I'm not going to give their name, but I just felt this morning that nobody's talking positive about their chronic sickness. Everybody's just speaking negative. So I was just like confessing and say, listen, this is my personal experience. Mm-hmm. This is what I was doing. I was putting God first. I'm praying for healing. Other people like yourselves is praying for me. And I didn't force anybody to do what I've said. I just said to them, listen, this is my personal experience. And maybe whoever wants to must just look maybe at what, how good and great is God. And this one woman was actually taking me on so bad that like she was really like swearing to me on this page. And then what I've done, I've just write back to her and say, listen, you do what's good for you. I will do what good that's good for me. How do you just leave something like that? Or because you know you really get a little bit of stirred up in such a, because writing is a thing that I put down I put down what I feel in my heart.
Yeah. Now, these people that attack you, especially on Facebook, that's why be very careful what you write, how you write it. And what I normally do is I just write my things, what I want to say, and then I never go back and see what they say.
Yeah.
Get upset. I don't. So that if they want to say something or slander my name or whatever, it's up to them. I'm not even going to try and defend myself or anything.
Unfortunately, Facebook is a wicked thing, because a lot of pastors attack each other on Facebook.
That too.
So don't take to monitor
your gevoelens daar uitdra nie.
Ja. Don't take your gevoelens daar uit neem en seer kry daar uit nie. Want mense
Because I thought it was a good thing to say something positive, because that whole page was so negative, you know. But I've learned.
You give your testimony and your words, but don't take anything personal or whatever. I've had tons of attacks already myself, but what I do is I just ignore it and I move on. I just don't watch it or anything. If they attack me personally on Messenger or something like that, then I block them.
Yes,
just leave it and I just move on. I don't always even go back to go and read what they say or anything like that. So rather don't say anything.
No, for sure. Thanks very much. Thank you also for the teaching. It's quite interesting and I think we all learn a lot of the teaching. Thanks very much, Susan and Dion.
It's only a pleasure. I hope it meant something.
Anybody else has got a question on tonight's teaching? Nobody. Then we go over to the practicals. Is everybody there? Brandon, you've got a question.
Brandon?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Now you're gone. Yeah, please speak, Brandon.
Okay, Brandon.
You can speak.
I just want to assist one of our sister who was experiencing I can say blasphemy over the internet.
Yeah, sure.
Yes, it's very true. One need to be, you need to have a look at the, what you call it, the Bible, where it says, do not give the pearls to the pig, they walk over it. So it's very, very important. The revelation you got is through the Holy Spirit to give to you.
Mm.
You must remember, the world is full of non-believers. Anything that you will try to put, say that it's a revelation, the world doesn't know. They don't understand who is the Holy Spirit.
Mm-hmm.
We are like another tribe. This world, where when we say Jesus to others, many of the people in the Facebook, they don't believe in Christianity.
Mm.
They respond in any way. To such an extent that if you are, you need to be, the Bible says you need to be wise as a snake and be vigilant.
Mm-hmm.
So every time when you, I remember there was a time, it's not, people are not only resistance over the what you call the Facebook only. Even when you are trying to give somebody a prophetic message, most especially as a beginner, you can be very, very much be discouraged. You can see, maybe you saw a vision, like you must remember when God begin to teach you how to prophesy. Sometimes, let me give you an illustration. This is how it works for me. God used to reveal to me, for example, maybe I'm going to minister tomorrow, or I'm going to church, maybe along the way, or the day before, you find that I knew about all the, for example, like sickness of the people, the causes of it and everything. God will reveal everything to me. In most cases, I'll write those things down. When I go to church, as I'm attending, maybe I'm a minister, I've been invited as a minister or I'm not invited. I am there, God begin to remind me of everything that I wrote down. So when I begin to speak the mind of God, and then now because people are there, I'm busy praying, I'm connected. As I'm speaking the mind of God, as I'm praying, God begin to reveal to me, you remember this prophecy I gave you? This is from this person. This is from this person. So immediately, through the grace of God, I managed to get a platform where, even though I know this is the person that I'm talking about, usually I'll go there in front and then I just make an altar call. Maybe, for example, I say, there's someone in our midst, you're suffering from this and this and this. There's someone in our midst. Now it lets, it's a, not that I do not know who is sick. You understand? Because sometimes when you point, you say, this particular person, you point at it. Some of the people, they want to prove you wrong. You understand? So we need to be very, very much careful in that kind of situation. And the other thing, you praying in a situation where maybe you are fighting against the spirit of darkness. You remember the Bible's talking about the seven sons of Sceva. Jesus, being the one man, he casted seven demons.
Yeah.
But the sons of Sceva, they were defeated by one demon.
Mm.
Why? The Bible is reminding us something there. Yes, it's for believers, like what you can say. According to Mark chapter 16, verse 16, all those who believe in my name, they will lay hands on the sick will be healed as it goes down. They'll speak in new tongues. But you may find that, okay, I believe. The question can be this: do you have the gifts? You understand? I believe we shall lay hands on the sick, they will recover. You need to have the gifts. That's the one she's talking about. That we'll talk about that next time. So, through those gifts, when you understand, when you operate, you have a free rule because you understand who you are. You understand what you're capable of. It's like when player when he's in the field. For example, let me give by Messi, for example. We know what is he capable of when he's on the field. You can't take Messi and you put him back line. You understand what I'm trying to say?
Mm.
Always you put him where they say he's a midfield camp striker. That's why he's very strong. So in that case, you need to know that it's very, very much important that you must discover the gift inside of you. That's what I believe was this interposing. After you discover, it becomes easy. For example, Peter says, as they were about to enter the beautiful gates, silver and gold, we have none. But what I have, I give you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, raise up and walk. He knew what he has. What I'm trying to say is, do not be discouraged of what the people are. When you raise something, they start to say it, criticize it or whatever. But what you need to be sure of, you know what you're capable of. Continue. What makes me to stand where I am, it's one thing. I continue. I remember there was a scenario in, it was 97 years back. Was just from, I was just maybe 2 years believer. Then it happened that through the grace of God, I was attending the pastor's seminars in our area. So while we were there, they asked the mind of God. I stood up and began to share what God revealed to me. I saw people divided. I'm talking about ministers of God, they were divided. Three of the people were saying, this is the prophecy from God. The rest denied the prophecy. And what happened? The prophecy came to pass. So I want to tell you that do not be discouraged. If you hear from God, speak forth, prophesy.
Amen.
Yes.
Amen.
Thank you. Thanks so much.
Powerful. Thank you, Brandon.
Thank you, Brandon, for sharing.
Okay. I'm just trying to get all the names quickly of everybody on. I see I'm missing one person, and that is Galaxy 18. I don't know who that is. Can you maybe just tell me what your name is, please, sir?
Mm-hmm.
I've got everybody else, but I don't know who Galaxy 18 is. Because I just want to, the reason for start playing a game, I want you to be part of it. I don't want you to miss out, to lose out, to anything. I want everybody to be playing with us. We're seeing that we're not many people. It's going to be fairly quick. It won't take too long to get through it.
And we missed Pastor McPherson.
Yeah, he dropped off.
Maybe that.
Probably,
Data. A lot of people don't have a lot of data.
And Galaxy, I thought it was Joseph because his phone sometimes read like that. Maybe it's not.
I'm just gonna share my screen. I'm not getting any response here, so I'm not gonna carry on. You can always add your name like that. Okay, let me just share my screen quickly. I wanna show you what I'm doing. It's first that one. Yeah, share. Okay, let's go into the practicals. We're gonna play games quickly, just two. So I'm gonna give it 2 minutes, or we're all gonna have like 2 minutes or something. We just get a chance to get a vision, get a picture, get a scripture, get a word, get a color. Whatever you feel like, you don't have to explain, to know what it means or anything like that. I just want you to just practice and just hear something from God, especially if you've never done it before. I want you to take 2 minutes and just hear and see if you don't get something. Whatever comes to mind, whatever pops up, normally that first moment, that first thing, take note of that and Just write that down or keep it for a minute for yourself, and then we're going to give each other a chance to share. Then I'm going to spin a wheel. And the name it lands on, you can share. Now, okay. But we actually are. We actually think we're enough people now, so we can maybe make it a bit longer. So we can spin the wheel, and the name that it lands on, you can share your prophecy that you get. But you don't know for who it is yet. I'm going to spin the wheel again. And that word is then for the person on the second spin. Does it make sense?
Sense. Does anybody understand?
What I'm trying to do is I want to make it random. In other words, God needs to know for who a prophetic word is. And I want to take the fear out of our own hearts. That insecurity. What am I going to say for that person now? If I give you a name and I tell you you must prophesy over that name or share a vision with that person, you're going to like, oh my word, what am I going to say to that person? You're going to sit and stare at the person and nothing's going to come. So I want you to just be at peace. Only trust God, because we're in the atmosphere of God's presence at the moment. And we just want to have you to hear from God. And he knows what's going to happen. I've already prayed. We've already prayed about it. We know God can speak. He's already spoken through us. We know what's going to happen. And I just want you to breathe, relax. While I'm busy talking, start listening what God is saying. And I'm going to just give you the moment. So I'm going to go over to that wheel now. So let me stop sharing this screen. And share the other screen. That one. So there's the wheel. So if you're scared of going first, one of us, either Dion or myself, can go first with what we've got, just so that you can see how it works. And then I'll spin the wheel, and whoever names it lands on them, you can start then with that person.
Okay, I will go first, just to break the ice, just to show you how it works. I don't know what, Lord already gave me a word. Okay. I don't know for who we, now, for who that word is. And we're going to spin the wheel, and that name that, the name that comes up, I know that prophecy is for that person. Okay. That's how we're going to do it. It's just that you don't get insecure, because if I tell you, okay, Charles, you're going to prophesy over Mandy, then you're not, oh, what am I? It's the first time I'm doing it. We just want you to hear something from God. Even if it's a Bible scripture, just one word, like the Lord loves you. That one word can change a person's life just by hearing the Lord loves you. Okay. If you don't get anything, it's fine. It's not a problem. Just tell them you didn't get anything. It's fine. It's just to hear from God. That's all it is. So I'll go first. And Susan can spin the wheel, and I'll see who the person is. With. Okay, spin the wheel.
But let's give everybody just a minute quickly, just to calm down. And just
hear. You're just going to take 2 minutes. It's easier to close your eyes. Then you take 2 minutes, and you just wait on the Lord and see if you can see a picture or a Bible verse or a word or something like that. Okay. Is everybody ready? You need a little bit more time. Everybody good?
Okay. Let's spin the wheel and see what happens. Just for the fun of it, make it random.
Okay. All right, Betty, this is from the Lord for you, Betty. Okay. So what the Lord showed me, the Lord has told you, you were going through a metamorphosis process. You were like a little worm, but now the worm it went into a cocoon. And you don't know what is going to happen in that cocoon, because you think you're still a worm. And that in the little cocoon is a metamorphosis process taking place. And out of that little cocoon comes a beautiful butterfly. At first you thought you were a worm, but now you turned into a beautiful butterfly. Also, but I also saw a small mustard seed plant being planted in a month. So through that whole metamorphosis process, being a Christian, I saw a small seed like a mustard seed, and this little mustard seed was being planted in a pot plant pot. And over the years, as it get watered, it grow and it grow and it grow. And now that tree is so big it can't fit into the pot anymore, so it needs to be planted. But the Lord says it was your faith. By your faith what's growing, it started small. Your geloof was klein, let you know, now word it groter and groter and groter. And that's now so monster saw. And here is what you saw, you buy a water gegeven, and he gave you, I'll interpret it just now, let me just speak to an Afrikaans and I'll interpret it just now for you. And I buy water gegeven, and you buy a kunstmis gegeven, and water was die Heilige Geest, and die kunstmis is die woord van God. En soos wat jy gegroeid en gegroeid, het jy begin, meer en meer geoefen raak in die Here se woord. En jy was, die Here sê vir jou op hierdie stadium, jy was soos een babakie wat hy vir jou gegee het. En die babakie gewoonlik is een bediening, en die Here het vir jou een goeie bediening gegee. En hy sê wel, hierdie babakie wat jy het eerst geleer om te kruip en te loop, en het was starig en gemakkelijk gegaan, en toe het jy in oor gegaan in die tienerproces, en jy het begin oefen dit wat die Here vir jou sê, en nou is jy in die basis van volwassen proces, en die Here sê, dit is nou tot om jy reisies te hardloop. Het jou door alle gekies gevat, het jou opgeleiding gegeen, alle goeders en Here sê, dit is nou proces dat jy met jou bediening begin, en dit is wat die Here vir jou te sê het. So die goeders wat die Here jou deurgevolg het, was die hele proces wat hy gevat, jy vat en Here sê, dit is nou tyd om jou bediening te begin, en jy is al reeds bezig daarmee. Jy is bezig om gekies in plek te sit, en dit is wat die Here vir jou so sê, dit is net een informatie vir jou, om te sê, dat die Here het goed. So, to all the English people, what I told Letty is, I saw she went through a metamorphosis process. She was first a little worm, started as a worm, and when she went into a cocoon, and then she became a butterfly. But then I also saw in a little pot plant, she was a small little mustard seed. She was planted in a little pot plant holder, you know, the pot plant holders. But this tree grew and grew and grew, and it became to be this mustard seed. And now it's started out into the garden. But it's a faith. A mustard seed is talking about your faith. She first had little faith, but now her faith started to grow and grow and grow and grow and grow. And now the Lord also showed me a picture of a baby. And the baby is usually, when you get a picture of a baby, it can be a physical baby. But in this instance, it's not a physical baby. A baby is a ministry. It's a ministry. So the Lord gave her a ministry, but she first in a ministry, you have to learn how to walk, you have to crawl, you have to learn all the baby steps first. When you go into your teen process, where you start experiencing stuff, you're experiencing, you want to try stuff and that. Now she's in an adult stage. And now she can fully live out a ministry gifting that the Lord has given her. And now she can teach others also in that gifting, and she can start blessing others. That's the word that I received for her. So you see how a lot of pictures form prophetic word. But I'm not going to expect you to do that right now. Just get one little picture and then we will help you. And next week, I will be taking the session, and I'm going to concentrate on specifically on dreams, visions, and prophetic symbolism. That's the session I'm going to take next week with you. So just relax. If you don't get something this week, it's fine. If you get just a Bible script, it's fine, because that word that you've got is for somebody that we're going to spin that wheel on. So, okay. So if anybody is ready, little race van thing that...
Letty can go,
or anybody... Share. But,
yeah.
Okay.
No,
you can share, and then we spin the wheel again
I see. Yeah, the only word, well, the only word, not scripture, the word that I'm getting is forgiveness. It seems like there's family, it's like there's not forgiveness. Somebody in the family don't want to forgive. That's what is my heart. That's the word I'm getting.
It's fine. Yes, that's fine. That's spot on. See where it is. See, the Lord knows. And it's myself. There's a lot of things that happened in my life, and it's true. I'm honest. There's a lot of things that happened in my life, but I need to forgive people, and I'm still stuck in that strut. Because there's a lot of things that happened in my childhood, especially in my childhood, and those people I must forgive, and it's very hard for me because I still get flashbacks from that memories, and it makes me trigger points within me. But let this one. To work through a forgiveness process again. So she's quite right. She heard from the Lord. See how she...
So that's good.
Information that I need to do it. I know I must do it, but I struggle to do it. And I'm honest when I say I struggle to do it.
Okay. Interesting. Okay. Anybody else to go?
Okay, Brandon, you can go.
Go, Annalie.
Annalie, Brandon, who wants
either
to go?
Either one of you can.
Annalie, okay, ladies first.
Ladies
let Annalie go. Let Annalie go. Okay, Annalie,
okay. I just got a word for somebody. I felt the Lord was saying, I want to take you further than you ever went before, deeper into my presence. Hold on to all the promises I gave you. Each one will be fulfilled. Just hold on to me. You did not hear wrong.
Amen.
Amen. Good
Amen.
Word. Beautiful.
Powerful.
And it's for you, Brandon.
It's for me now.
That was for you.
That was for yourself, yeah.
Did you hear what you said, Brandon?
Did you hear what Annalie said? Okay, we're recording it. We'll put it on YouTube so you can listen to over and over it again. Okay.
Okay, what did you say?
Annalie repeat it because I'm going to miss some of the stuff that you said.
Okay, what I felt the Lord is saying, he said, I want to take you further than you ever went before, deeper into my presence. Hold on to all the promises I gave you. Each one will be fulfilled. Just hold on to me. You did not do it wrong.
Amen.
Thank you very much.
Okay, Brandon.
Share your word.
Share your word, Brandon.
Yes, it's my word. All right. Thank you very much for the privilege or platform you're giving us. So I just want to, they say, who's in USA? Do we have a person in USA with us?
That's Julie.
It's Julie.
Julie, you still there?
You're still there, Julie?
Yes, I am. I'm here.
Okay. Right.
Julie, I want you to
pray. Brandon is sidestepping the process.
Yes, Brandon is sidestepping the process, but it's all right. It's fine. Okay.
Julie, I want you to pray. There is a possibility. There's a conflict. Your country has got conflicts with another country, which can result into a war. Not one, it's not two, it's not three. Those countries, that's against your country.
I'm not understanding you, I'm sorry. I don't know what you said.
Okay, your country has got
America.
America, USA.
Mm.
I want you to intercede on behalf of USA. There is a possibility getting involved into a war. This war can affect the whole world. I want you to pray to continue to intercede on behalf of your country. If possible, God I'm seeing God want to use you on the role of intercession, that will gather men and women to pray, begin to pray for your country.
Thank you so much. I receive it.
Yes, and the other thing, agriculture.
What? Agriculture?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, your country need to be involved in agriculture. More in agriculture.
Okay, I received that.
Yes, for economy to boom. Because yes, what we are, when people looking at your country from far, they see everything is well, but agriculture. USA need to invest in agriculture.
Okay.
Yes, begin to pray. I believe you also play a role in that matter. Continue to
Thank
pray.
You so much, Brandon.
Yes, God will lead you how. And I also have a concern. You see, Jesus, what I want to say is faith. That is true. We can be men or women of faith. It doesn't mean that we cannot come across with problems. Mm. I want you to listen to what I want to say. Trouble is the soil in which faith flourish.
I didn't understand that. Brandon, are you asking me to do this? Or yes. Are you saying that God is asking me to do this?
Yes, trouble is the soil in which faith flourish. What am I trying to say? Whatever situation that you are coming across with, that is giving you concern. Do not worry, because that is where our God will show himself through you. Understand what?
Okay, Brandon, I have a question for you. Yes. When you were speaking this word,
yes,
and you said, I, so is it you that is telling me to do this, or is it God telling me to do this?
Thank you very much. There is this type of a prophet that are called Nabi. When they prophesy, they say, I is God.
Brandon,
of the prophets.
Brandon,
yes, yes.
Sorry for stopping you, Brandon. This is like high level stuff, Brandon. I don't want to be rude, but this is high level stuff that you're telling the people now, Brandon. Keep it for time, okay? Just play along with the game tonight, okay?
Yes.
To stop you, I know what you're trying to do, but it's high level stuff. People don't understand that high level stuff yet, okay?
All right. Thank you.
Okay, Brandon. Just play the game for tonight. We're going to go further into the sessions. We're going to go into the deeper flow of the prophetic. Okay.
Yes. Yes. I believe so.
Okay. All right.
Thank you so much, Brandon.
Yes.
I have a word too.
Sure. Julie.
Okay, Julie.
Okay. When we started to do our 2 minutes, I saw this bright light, and it was very bright. And this is the word that I got from Matthew 5, 15 and 16. Neither do you light a lamp and put it, hold on 1 second. Put it under a bushel, but on a candlestick, and it giveth light unto all that are in the house. 16. Let your light shine before men, that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven. And that's all that I got.
Okay, that's good. It's good, Judy.
That's powerful, Judy.
That's powerful.
Who is that?
Powerful, let us see it, eh?
Mandy.
There you go. It's for you, Mandy.
Where's Mandy? She's there.
She's there. Okay.
Andy?
My phone break off.
Signal is breaking. Julie, can you maybe just repeat that for Mandy quickly? It's Matthew 5, verse
15 and 16. And before I read it, I just want to say that I saw a very bright light. So your light is very bright within you, your desire to share. And this is what Matthew chapter 5, verses 15 and 16. And this is the King James Version, verse 15. Neither do men light a candle and put it under a bushel, but on a candlestick, and it giveth light unto all that are in the house. Verse 16, let your light shine before men, that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven. And earlier this morning, I got this word, I could smell bread. And what I got was that fresh manna, and manna represents provision. So I would like to share that with you, Mandy, that that you will have fresh manna daily, provision daily. Amen.
Amen.
Sure. Thank you very much.
You're very welcome.
Okay. Thank you, Julie. Thank you. Andy, have you got a word for somebody?
Wow, my, there was not a word, there was not just a gevoel what I got. I had such a calm to be over my gekregen. And all what I had to net gehoor het, soos dit, dis asof a mens net gedink het, of ek in het gedink het, maar ek het nie in het gedink nie. Dan het ek net soos heel tyd gehoor dat iemand vir my sê, alles gaan okay wees. Net alles gaan okay wees. En dan as ek daarin dink, dan voel ek soos half hartseer, maar dan voel jy ook die kalmte boor jou. En ek weet nie.
Ja,
yeah,
that's
exactly
how it works.
Dat
is hoe dat werk. Dat
is
precies
hoe dat
werk. That's exactly how it works. Just
for... Keer is het een gevoel wat een mens krijg. Jy is heel te mooi.
Ja.
I
tried to explain in my message today as well as... You get that feeling coming over you. You don't hear anything, you don't see anything, but you just have that feeling.
Yeah.
And that's what I'm experiencing now, Mandy, is just that sense of everything's going to be okay. Something, you should be panicking, but it's going to be all right. That feeling, you know that. And that's how the prophetic works sometimes. It's just that sensing. So let's see who that is for. Is for Renel. Where's Renel? Let me say I'm with our share.
Ja, ek sal, en ek dink dat daai woord is definitief so vir Renel, hoor. So vir Renel, ja.
You see how it works, people. Can you roll it at work? For sharing the other stuff, but like I said, I just want to keep it basic tonight, Brandon. We'll give you some other time to go high level stuff. I want you to, when I go high level stuff, I'm going to use you to go high level stuff, okay?
Yes, no problem.
All right.
We still love you.
We still love you.
I know I'm loved.
You can come and visit. You know, you're always welcome.
I know I'm loved so much.
Yes,
that's good. You're always welcome.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, see now that Renel here is, nie? Dat maar mijn gegeven.
Yeah, you look like
let me share mine that I got last night. I got a vision that I saw a white flower of somebody picking the leaves. That what they say, he loves me not. He loves me not. That whole situation, asking and questioning and not always sure, does God love you or not? But God says it's time for you to make up your mind that he loves you. There's no question about it. He loves you. He says, I died once and I died for all. There's nobody excluded, nobody sin that's too big or anything like that. He loves us. And he knows those who trust in him. And he gave me Nahum 1 verse 7 and Psalm 34 verse 8 and 22. All of it says God knows those who trust in him. So don't doubt whether he knows you or loves you or don't see you, if you're just a face in the crowd or a voice in the crowd or anything like that. He knows you and he loves you and he will look after you. Let's see, who is that for? André.
Awesome.
Where's André?
Awesome.
Jy is nog gemute, André. Jy is gemute.
Does it? I'm here.
Does
it? Good. Okay, I've got that one.
Okay.
Thank you, Shishan.
Okay.
Okay.
Anybody else?
Well, André needs to share his
word. Okay, on my, Runel, on my side, I've got the idea that the Lord says to this person, you are a man after my own heart. That's it.
Amen.
Beloved by God.
Amen.
See who that is.
Julie, do you hear what André said, Julie?
I did, and I love it. Thank you, Lord. Makes me happy. Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
It's only a pleasure.
Okay, so I can take your name out of now, Julie.
Pardon me?
So I can take your name out of the list now because you received the word and you shared the word.
Oh, amen. Amen. Yes. So, before you continue, can I just say something to Brandon?
Yes.
Brandon, I hope that I did not offend you. And if I did, I truly want to apologize to you. But in America, when we are saying something that the Lord is saying, we say the Lord said, or Jesus said, or God said, so that it takes the attention off of us and onto God. So I just have to learn other nations' way of prophesying. So it's not personal, okay?
It's not personal, I know. I understand.
Okay, thank you so much.
We're friends in the Lord. Yeah?
Absolutely. Yeah, I'm your sister in the Lord.
Yes, there's nothing to worry about. We are one.
To clarify.
Yes, oh, Brandon is from Venda, Judy.
From where?
From Venda. Yeah, he comes from Venda, but they stay in Pretoria. He's also a prophet from Venda. Yeah.
Okay.
You're from me.
Walking with us
for a long, long time. That's why I stopped him and said, not now for the high level stuff, because I know.
Well, I'm probably going to learn something from him, and I appreciate that.
He's very strong in the prophetic.
He's very strong in the prophetic.
Amen.
Amen. Okay, who else wants to go?
Let's meet Laura.
Ek het net gekry, be still and now I am the Lord.
Amen. That's a powerful scripture. God deals with that often. Let's see who is that for. Annelie.
Maak
het sin vir jou, Annelie.
Dankie, Laura. Hey, Laura.
Hallo.
Wie is nog
Charles het nog oor, André het gekry en geshare.
Kom het afgevan, Charles, hè?
Charles is nou skielik weg. Toch. Okay, so everybody, Angel, you want a word?
Angel? Hello?
Good evening.
Good evening. Where you been hiding, hè?
Been hiding?
I have been hiding. But I've been part of the session.
Okay, that's good. Yep. Nice seeing you again, huh?
Likewise. What's
your voice? Sammy and Joshua doing well?
All good. Keeping me busy.
Okay, that's good. Okay. Gaan jy woord gee vir, kom ek al maar vir Charles, kom ons kyk. Okay, so Angel, I'm just going to put you in here.
It's you and Angel, sir.
Yeah, it's me and Angel and Laura, we haven't received the word yet.
Okay.
So whoever wants to give us a word is welcome. Okay, who wants to give Laura a word?
Have you received something, Angel? Do you receive something from the Lord, Angel? Hello?
But I've been talking to myself.
Okay.
Yes, I've got a word for Laura.
Okay.
The Lord says, I'm the same yesterday, today, and forever.
Ever. Amen. Okay. Amen.
Thank you.
Okay.
Amen. Right. What I'm going to do now, just for the last game.
We're going a little bit over time, but we're almost finished.
If you want to play, but I just want to, just a little bit more practice.
I have a word for Susan.
Oh, yes, please.
I heard the Lord say to tell you that there are many languages inside of you and that He is going to bring them out.
Wow.
Amen.
Let it be.
It's confirmation, Judy. It's because the Lord called her as a mother of a nation. So that's why there's a lot of
language.
Oh,
amen.
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 Amen. But also the speaking in tongues on that side.
I would love to have
multiple tongues. Not just one. I'm looking for that.
Amen.
Okay, so our last game quickly. Take 2 minutes. I'm going to spin the wheel for one person, so that's like a jackpot situation. And then everybody prophesies for that one person. So first get a word, and then I'll spin the wheel, and then we can all share our word that we've got for that person. Now let's just take a minute or so and just see if we get something. If you don't get something, it's all right.
Everybody ready? Everybody comfortable? Everybody ready? Okay, let's
see.
Yes. All right, so let's see who's going to be our special person for tonight.
Andre.
It's Andre. Okay.
Andre, is jy reg vir woord vir jou?
Reg vir woord vir my.
I'm ready, thank you.
Okay. Anybody wants to go first or must I go first? I don't care. Judy, you want to go first?
Oh, okay, okay.
Because you were laughing, that's why I thought you...
No, that's fine.
Okay.
But you can go first. You can go first.
No, I'm ready.
Okay, go.
I heard follow ground, F-A-L-L-O-W, ground, and that would become good soil. Mm-hmm. So in Hosea chapter 10 and verse 12 says, sow to yourselves in righteousness, reap in mercy. Mm-hmm. Oh, I'm sorry. King James. I guess that's right. So to, let's see, I'm going to do it in the Amplified. Sow with a view to righteousness, that righteousness, like seed, may germinate. Reap in accordance with mercy and loving kindness. Break up your uncultured ground, for it is time to seek and search diligently for the Lord and to long for his blessing until he comes to rain righteousness and his gift of salvation to you.
Amen.
Thank you, Julie.
Okay. Anybody You're else? Anybody else wants to go? Okay. I'm sorry, what the Lord is... Okay, you can... Fun.
Yes.
Hallo. Yeah. Okay,
ek kan net hierdie liedjie gehoor. Daai liedjie wat gaan is trust and obey, for there's no other way. To be happy in Jesus is to trust and obey. Dat is die liedjie wat ek net gehoor het. Ja.
Dankie.
From my side, what I've picked up as well is I just saw a big seashell lying on the shore, and as you walk past, you pick it up and you listen to hear the sea. And God says, in that same way as you pick up the shell, you pick up the word, you will hear His voice.
Amen.
Thank you.
Amen.
Andre, you got something?
Yes, from my side, pray for your health.
Okay. You can pray for Andre's health, it's fine. Pray for yourself.
Yes.
Okay, pray for yourself. What's the problem, Brandon?
Okay, thank you. Let me go.
What the problem is? What's the problem with Andre? Andre, wat jy enige gesondheidsprobleme tans of nie?
Nee, niks wat ek van weet nie.
Niks wat jy van weet nie. Nie pyn, bloeddruk, enigiets. Nie siek gewees, COVID, nee. Enigiets gehad nie. Niks.
Okay. Niks nie.
Okay.
And we just pray for your protection. We'll stay protection. Like
that. Father, we just pray for protection over Andre, that no health issues will come his way. We plead the blood of Jesus over his life and say, no health issues will touch Andre's body. No sicknesses, no issues, nothing will touch Andre's body. We pray it in Jesus' mighty name. Amen.
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 Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen.
Ek het ook healing gekry, terwyl ek maar net gesê het, my his wounds you have been healed.
Yeah.
1 Peter 2 verse 24, that's the only word I got you off for.
Maar by sy wonde het daar genesing vir jou gekom.
Correct, yes.
Daar sy dankie nou.
Can I share something? I have something for him. I'm just looking at him, and he looks like the picture of health. And in Psalms 91, it says that no sickness or disease would come near your dwelling place.
Nice.
In Jesus' Amen. Name.
Thank you.
Amen.
Stand in agreement with that.
Okay, Andre, what I see from the Lord says, He's the true vine, and you are one of the branches. you went through, he took you through a pruning process, and he pruned you, and you started to bud. And through the budding process, you started to carry fruit. And the Lord said, your fruit are good. So he took some of your fruit and he put it in the wine press. And he started trotting on the the fruit in the wine press. And he says, the wine press process is not an easy process, and it's not a nice process, but it's a process that you had to go through. And the Lord says, that wine process is now finished. And the Lord is taking now the new wine that came out of the wine press. He says, he's taking that new wine and he's putting it into new wine sacks. And you are putting your new wine that the Lord has made from your fruit into new wine sacks, that you can go and dish it out to the people.
Thank you, Neil.
Wat die Here in jou ingesit het, André, moet jy nou vat en gaan uitgiet na die mense toe. Die woord wat die Here jou gegee het, alles wat die Here vir jou van evangelisasie geleer het in hierdie tydperk van COVID, die Here sê, is nou reg om al die goeders te vat na die mense wat die Here vir jou uitwys.
Baie dankie.
Was sien. Almal gegaan?
Angel, Laura, you guys got something? For André?
Ek het net gekry, ja, die Here sê, ek reed jou met my rechterhand.
Amen. Angel, did you receive something for André?
Nothing from my side, thanks.
Okay, it's not a problem. Not a problem. Okay, everybody.
Okay, well.
Thank you for joining tonight's session. We hope you were blessed by it and that you learned something.
Absolutely.
You all have a blessed week. And then next week, I will take
Let's see.
Oh,
sure.
Okay,
Amen.
Sorry.
Very good.
Yeah.
Shalom.
Kijk, vraag ook aan Annelie. Is dat right?
André, bid jullie nog steeds vir mense? Want ek weet in my national mind dat jullie altijd vir mense gaan bid.
Ons doen ja. Heeltemal.
Ek ervaar net die Here wat jullie meer daarin gebruik in 'n groter mate. Wat jullie gesaai het in al die tyd, gaan jullie begin die vrug sien wat die Here vir jullie gaan begin gee daarin.
Okay. Dit klink fantastisch. Baie dankie, Annelie.
Okay. All right, from my side and from Susan's side, we just would like to say thank you for joining us tonight on the Prophetic Voice. We hope you enjoyed tonight's teaching and that you learned something and that you enjoy the practicals. Next week, we will back be next week, and I will be covering dreams, visions, and some how to interpret prophetic symbolism. And then if you want to sow a seed in our ministry, you're more than welcome. Susan's got all the details on the screen there. Or if you want to get the bank information, we will gladly email it to you or WhatsApp it to you. But everything is there if you feel in your heart you want to sow a seed. And thank you for joining. And have a good evening and sleep well. And then have a blessed week.
Thank you so much.
Amen.
Everybody. Amen. Shalom, everybody. Amen. Bye-bye.
Thank you so much.
Good
Bye-bye.
Evening,
good
evening
thank everybody.
Thank you for joining.
Thank you for
Bye. The end.